I don't want nobody else to ever love me. You are my shining star, my guiding light, my love fantasy. There's not a minute, hour, day or night that I don't love you. You're at the top of my list, cause I'm always thinking of you. I still remember in the day that I was scared to touch you. How I spent my days dreaming, planning how to say I love you. You must have known that.
Welcome to Career Talk Bella Style with Alicia Madison and Shay Calhoun. Shay's not joining us today, so we're really sad because today is our last show of the season. But we really just want to thank you for tuning in as we bring you professional women that bring us wonderful tips and some of their empowering ways to help with their career. So today we have Dee Tutt. Dee is the CEO of DTRS Enterprises. Did I say it right, Dee?
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah. And so she's bringing us Seville. So Dee has a fabulous story about how she got into her drink product. It's a Rum-tini. So if you've never heard of a Rum-tini, you're going to learn more about it today with Dee. So Dee, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Alicia, and thanks for having me.
Oh, we're excited that you're here. We're excited to learn more about what you've been doing with your career because you just have this fabulous career being able to run a huge product. And actually, you're like Chicago, LA, New York.
Yes. Alicia, I've been all over, and actually, this brand, it came about in my kitchen.
In your kitchen?
So that's interesting enough, because I was a hairstylist for 19 years.
Okay.
And my degree is in psychology, and but you need that, being a hairstylist.
Yeah, you definitely do, yes.
Yes, because that's what you do, is listen to people's problems and make them feel good.
Yeah.
And in my travels from... I was born and raised here in Los Angeles, California, mm-hmm. and I moved from here to New York, just right outside New York City, and then Atlanta, Georgia, and Chicago, mm-hmm. and I reside there now and here in Los Angeles.
Oh, wow, wonderful, wonderful. So now, you said you were born and raised here in L.A., so what took you to New York? Was that to... while you were doing hair, were you doing something else?
No, actually, hair was not in my cards, okay. But you never know what you're going to end up doing. But my husband, my ex-husband, he worked for a company that every time he was promoted, we were moved, so we were transferred. So I lived in New York for 2 years,
okay.
And then from 2 years in New York, then to Atlanta.
Oh, wow, wow. Yes. So now, were you moving with his career or...?
Yes, I was moving with his career because I had two small children at the okay. time. And when I moved to Georgia, I decided to do something I was passionate about, which was hair, healthy okay. hair. And I went to beauty college there and got my license. And then once I got licensed there, we were moved again to the Chicago region.
Wow, wow. So now, I know you said with the Seville product that you started it in your kitchen. So what made you move it from just something that you were doing in your kitchen to now... what it is today?
Well, I'll tell you this. This product came about over, I say, about 33 years ago.
Okay.
And I was hosting an event, and I made up what you call a rum punch. And I would travel through the Caribbean to the Caribbean islands, and I would sit with the bartenders and take a little of this from this island, a little of that from that island, and come home and try it out on my guests. And this is 30 years, you know, of each state that I lived in.
Mm-hmm.
And I listened to the oohs and the ahs, and it's to this, it's to that. And I tweaked it, you know, to the liking of the feedback that I was getting. Yeah. And then once I was in living in Chicago, this was like probably 27 years after I established the product,
uh-huh.
people stop asking me to make the product for them. It's like, could you please make this for my event? And then they encouraged me, put it on the market, put it on the market. So I had the means at the time to actually put a brand on the market. And I formed a team of people to help me launch this brand, Seville. And here we are.
Wow. So you went from a psychology degree to being a hair, you're working in hair industry.
Yes.
And then now you have your own brand of a rum
right
tea.
But let me just share with you the succession. I first was the hair business.
Okay.
And then while I was still doing hair, I got my degree in psychology. So it was just all preparing me to do something bigger and greater. And we turned this commercial my kitchen recipe into a commercial recipe about 3 or 4 years ago.
Wow. Yes. And so now you have yours in, I mean, it's Chicago. So your home base is Chicago for the product.
Well, home base is here in Los Angeles.
Okay.
We were going to launch our brand in Chicago region, but Chicago, if you've ever been there, you know we only have 3 months of summer.
So, yeah.
And 3 months of warmth. And it's hard to launch a tropical brand during the winter months there in Illinois. So I decided, well, you know, hey, let's bring it back to my roots, California, where I know they drink this type of a drink all year round.
No, so that's really important for somebody to consider when they're looking at their career or looking at a product for their company. Is where is the best place to market it? So you realize that your home base, Chicago at the time, wasn't the best place. And so you did what was best for your company and came back to sunny California.
Correct.
I'm sure that wasn't that hard.
No, it wasn't at all.
But to leave family, that's a big step. And to have to transition back and forth, because you went back and forth for a while, right?
Right, and I still go back and forth. And, you know, all my siblings are here.
Okay.
And my mom was here. So 3 years ago, you know, she passed away. And I actually just purchased the house that I was raised in. So that's nice that I'm here with my siblings. But, my husband, who's a big part of my company, he just pushes me along, and you know, he has that business acumen that maybe I might have missed in the beginning stages, but I'm there now. And so he helps me run the company. He's my CFO.
Okay.
He keeps a tight budget.
So now, do you have employees or?
Well, I contract people out.
Okay.
So we have people that will actually go out in sales reps and demos. We do a lot of marketing at events to let people know that the brand is on the market.
Right. So you have a team.
Yes,
so you have
a
team. It's not just Dee running around trying to do everything. So
yes. Well,
you realize for this kind of established brand, you couldn't do everything. So
right.
You do have a team. That's fabulous.
I have a team. My children are also on my team.
Oh, that's fabulous.
Yes, because they bring that millennial freshness to what, you know, when you're launching a brand, because they are big spenders in this environment that we're in now. So my kids bring a lot to the table, and my son, he's a business major. Both my kids, and my daughter's a business major as well.
Wow.
So they really help out a lot with me and my social media and, you know, everything that's needed for the brand.
So that's wonderful. So what I'm hearing is that you're leveraging all of the resources that you have at your fingertip to help out with, you know, some of the probably either challenges or situations that you have with your brand. So you're not just relying upon yourself to make some of the key decisions. You're pulling in, you know, the wisdom and the knowledge of people in your circle.
Right. And, you know, I have the people in my circle, but I also had outside counsel as well.
Wonderful.
So there was some gentlemen in Chicago who were my mentors. And they're in the alcohol industry, but they've 100 years total with these guys. And they were really nice guys. And they just said, hey, you know what? We're going to help you get this established. And so, you know, listening to them and then taking all that in, because you have to surround yourself with people who are in the industry of where you want to go.
Right.
So this is what I did. I leveraged them for what I needed to get started in the beginning. And this is not an easy process. I mean, it's a lot of work and time, and you're not going to be a millionaire overnight.
Right. And I see you putting in the work. Actually, how we met was someone who had come to one of my seminars told me about you and said, you know, really, for what the Bella Network is doing, it's an advocacy organization. This is someone that, you know, you could start helping her and introducing her to other people to display her product. So with you and I, we've had you come to a few events. And then now all of a sudden it's like, I'll call you about an event and you're already on board with them. So,
yes.
You know, that
yes.
helps too in that advocacy,
yes, it
right?
does. And that's what we rely on quite a bit is word of mouth. Mm-hmm. People just sharing that, you know, this brand is out there and letting people know. And one event leads to another event. It's always a positive response. People love the brand. And that's our marketing means because, you know, we're not a big corporation yet.
Right.
But what we're relying on is people just telling other people. We use social media a lot and just to get the brand out there. That's our means of marketing at this time.
Yeah, and so social media becomes really important for what you're doing and making sure that, you know, as people find out about it, it's easy for them to share so you have the right branding material out there so people can then share your material. So that's critical for that too.
Right, mm-hmm. right. And like I said, those who have tasted the brand, they really love the brand and they just want to see me succeed because it's not many women in the alcohol industry, the spirit industry.
Exactly.
And especially being a black woman in this industry. Actually, when I lived in Illinois and I would come through the doors with my mentors, they're looking like, what are you doing here?
Yeah.
You know, type of, you know, setting this like, you know, and, you know, a lot of the naysayers would say, you know what, this is too difficult for you to do. So, you know, just pack your bags and take your losses.
Yeah.
But
now I noticed that you now have small cans.
Yes.
So you went from the large bottles.
Yes.
So now you have the small cans. So I love the small cans.
Yes. Thank you. The bottle being new on the market, it was kind of a, you know, you've got to make mistakes.
Right.
We came out with too large of a bottle.
Too large of a bottle.
Some
okay.
states will not even allow a liter size bottle on the shelves, the mm-hmm. retail shelves, as in California, they do. So we've designed a new bottle that's smaller and more unique, and it doesn't look like a wine because people always say, what kind of wine is
right.
it? Even though I say it's a rum teeny, they say, what kind of wine is this?
Yeah.
So also the trend down here is, the trend around the U.S. is the single serve cans.
Right.
They're convenient. You could take it to the beach, to the park or whatever, concerts or what, you know. It's easy, it's compact, and yes, so we're coming out with a single-serve can.
And I like the single-serve can because I like it over ice cream.
Oh my
so
goodness.
Instead of having to open the whole bottle to just pour it over my ice cream, I can do the single-serve can. So you've sold me just on I love that size.
Yeah. And a lot of people like to mix our brand, although it doesn't need mixing.
No.
You can mix it with just about any spirit. I had a friend who tried it with his red wine, and he came up with his own creation, and it was absolutely delicious.
Mm-hmm. So now, when you went through the process of changing your bottle size, I mean, what all did that take? And what led you down that path? I know it was the size, because you wanted to go smaller, and then I know you talked about the fact that you wanted to move away from a wine bottle, but did you come up with your own kind of design or
yes, actually, I came up with my own design.
Okay,
and right now we're in the we're making the mold. They're making the mold for me, mm-hmm. and the bottle should be out soon. But I just thought of this drink as being something exotic and sexy,
mm-hmm.
so I came out with a really exotic, sexy design for our new packaging.
Yeah. So now I had the opportunity to see a copy of the new bottle, and it is sexy. So I kudos to you on that design because I think it's brilliant. It's beautiful. It's
Thank
really
you.
Alluring. And I think that you're right when it'll no longer have people look at it and say, "Oh, that's wine."
Right.
It takes away from that.
Yes.
So
and then once, you know, we pour out and they look at it and they say, oh, it's not wine. What, you know,
what
so they
it,
say,
right?
Even though I've told them several times, it's a rum, it's a rum cocktail, right, then, you know, they can see that it's a beautiful orange color.
So now, are you, you know, still in the phases of finding any other brands that you want to do, or is, you know, this it, or are you still, okay?
We have a lot of things brewing.
Okay.
Yes, we have quite a few different flavors that we're going to come out with, and also different mixtures.
So now, what does that take? So, you know, as a part of your business, do you have like taste testers that you use, or are you using your family members? I mean, so as a small, like you said, I think right now you're still an LLC corporation as a small business, and you have, you know, funds, but you have minimal funds for like testing and stuff. You know, what do you do to make sure that you stay ahead of the game for your industry with the spirits?
Well, what we do is when we're out doing events and just marketing things, advertising or whatever for our brand, we take our products out and we listen to the feedback of the people, mm-hmm, and what works, what doesn't work. I haven't found anything that doesn't work yet, but what works. And we just keep that information, and then we take it to our flavor house. So that's how my drink started here. It went from the kitchen to a flavor house to recreate it as much as possible, my kitchen recipe, and turn it into a commercial recipe. Mm-hmm. So that's a tedious process right there, because you want to make sure that the flavor still represents what you've made in your own home or whatever.
So now, how long was that process, and how involved was that?
Oh, wow, that was very involved. The process just for me to approve a taste, and I had a partner along the way to help me to come up with the taste of the brand, and it took about 6 months for just to approve a taste and then testing it out. And since I had a hair salon, you know, I had a lot of taste testers, and okay, I was like, oh no, this is not it. And I had them fill out forms, and you know, the consistency, the texture. It wasn't just like, oh, how does it taste? And
no, so we did a full survey of your audience. Okay.
Right. So we wanted to mimic what I made in the kitchen as much as possible, mm-hmm, to put in the bottle for a consumer.
Great. And then with, so now with the testing, you know, so we have the three different glasses here.
Yes.
So I know on your website you have it where you have different ways of mixing it. So you have the rum tini straight out of the glass. Then you also have a sangria that you do.
Yes.
So you have the recipe for that. So, you know, how did you come up with these different recipes that you can use? For?
Well, actually, that's where my millennials come in.
Okay.
So actually, my daughter came up with our sangria, which is, oh, delightful.
Yeah, I mean, that's my favorite, is a sangria.
So my daughter came up with that, and then my son, being a man, he's like, well, let's add a little tequila to it. So he mixed it with tequila, and then mom came along and just added a few other things to it with a tequila mix, and mm-hmm, it's just like, oh my gosh. It's just really flavorful.
Wow.
Yes.
Well, so I love how you have those recipes on your site, because that really helps with the flavoring and how to, you know, mix it for different types of foods. And I think you even have something on there where you relay it to foods, or do you do any kind of pairing for people?
Well, we have chefs. Actually, we have a renowned chef from Chicago coming in next week for Memorial weekend, and he's going to do a lot of different things with pairing ceviche and actually cooking ceviche with various dishes, using it in recipes. But the spicy foods go really well with ceviche. And you know what? Although we said that we can mix things with it, I just want people to know that it's best right out of the bottle.
Yeah, it's great. That's what
right
I said. I put
bottle.
It on ice cream.
Yes,
right out of the bottle.
You
it's
don't,
great.
You don't need to add anything to
nothing.
It. But like I said, the chef, I went to his home with he and his wife, and right there on the spot, he made a sauce for his cheesecake, and it was delightful.
Oh, wow.
So it's many, many things.
Oh, I can imagine.
Yes,
cheesecake.
Things
that
you can make that
would be great
with
for
ceviche. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Wow. So, Dee, you know, tell us, what are some of the challenges that you've had as you've gone through this process? So this is 30 years in the making. And so initially you didn't really foresee that this is where you would be, you know, actually having a bottled product 30 years ago.
No.
But like you said, 4 years ago, you went to the bottle. But during that transition, that time, what are some of the things that if you had to the chance to go back you may do different or that really helped you to hone in on what you have today?
One of the biggest things is that my initial research was said, oh, you only need like a few hundred thousand dollars to start a brand. False.
I mean, that's straight in the camera. False.
False. What you really need a lot of money to in order to get your brand out there. So much as the taking the kitchen to the commercial, that was, you know, okay. But actually the marketing aspects, where you want to go, where you want your drink to end up. And I don't see our drink only in the U.S., but internationally, we've gone international, and they really love our drink internationally. Mm-hmm. So it agrees with a lot of different palates. Mm-hmm. So what I would do differently is bring in the investors first.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, that's the, instead of using my own money.
Right. Yeah. So I know one of the things that we've talked about through this time is, you know, looking at adding some investors onto your palette in the way of helping.
Yes.
So yeah, that's critical. And I think that a lot of times people feel as though they have to wait until they have money, and they don't realize that sometimes there's things you can do with what you have now currently that you're not doing. And so many times I'll see people with brands and they'll get an influx of money, and instead of putting it back into their company, they're putting it into, oh, I have to go first class to event, or I have to go, you know, I have to buy the next, you know, this fabulous dress to wear to an event where I'm going to show off my brand.
Yes.
So it's really making those wise choices with
your
money.
You have to make wise choices and also wise choices with other people's money.
Yeah.
You know, you can't fly for until you're making the millions back and you pay back your investors. That's not the way to go.
Right.
I mean, people automatically, when they see you, they think you have a whole lot of money because you come up with a brand. We're making this brand work, and we're just so determined that we're keeping it afloat. One of my retailers just last week said to me, he said, I am so glad you're still in the business. Because we see them come and go within 2 years. And we've been on the market now since 2015. And actually, you know, sales are starting to pick up. So things are going pretty good. But the investment part, it's very difficult to bring in investors, especially when you're a woman of color.
Yeah. And I know one of the other issues that you're having, too, is even when you're selling it at different locations, you're kind of at the discretion of, you know, how that person wants to price it, too. So there's a lot that you have to play with in regards to your placement of product.
Right. We have no say-so over what the retailers sell our brand for. That's up to their discretion. They all ask you a suggested retail price, but we sell it to through a distributor. So it's a three-tier process here with alcohol, and they're very strict. There's no leniency with alcohol brands. So you have to have, I'm the wholesaler, then, or the manufacturer, it goes to a distributor, a liquor distributor, and then it goes to the retailer.
Wow.
So we have to follow those plans. So it goes through several channels before it actually hits the consumer.
But the good thing is you're not in your car driving to these different locations dropping it off.
Well, so let me tell you, in the beginning, you do what you have to do because with a new brand, you don't really get distribution right away.
Okay.
And actually, we're using self-distribution, and that's where I'm at right now. We're using self-distribution for our brand that allows us to go out and self-distribute. So I was that one-woman team that you talked about, that I was really, you know, going from San Diego to the Bay Area and making deliveries and making the sales call. So I was that one-woman team, but we've been fortunate to get a couple people who can help us out now and, you know, do those sales calls for me. And I just, you know, I actually do the ordering of the brand.
Wow, that's wonderful. Well, so I wanted to talk a little bit more about your cans. So why did you so this is a 6.8 ounce.
Correct.
Was there a reason why you made it this size versus another size? And was that a part of some study that was done based upon the industry? Or, you know, how did you come up? I know that you're changing the bottle size, But after you learned about the bottle size, was there some big, you know, to do with the can?
Or? Yes. The reason being, like I said, it's very restricted. You have to follow the laws. So it's an organization, it's called TTB, and they are in charge of the alcohol brands that come out, and they review everything before it hits the market. I mean, they make sure that you're not selling poison out there. Mm-hmm. It's totally different from food. You can get sick first, and then they'll pull it off the market. But this, they have to make sure that everything is in compliance. Mm-hmm. So they would not allow, we wanted to do a 300 milliliter can, was like maybe at like 8 ounces.
Yeah, so like the tall one.
Yes, they would not allow it.
Wow.
So we had to do the 6.8 ounce to be in compliance with the government.
So it's not just you coming up with a fabulous drink. You really have to learn the industry. Yep. And learn all the rules and all the different organizations that play within the industry. So that in itself is a full-time role, right?
Yes, it is. And it's fortunate that I was able to retire from doing hair. I was in California, and I'm, you know, back and forth to Chicago and hair appointments. And then I, you know, my husband and I just sat down and I said, hey, babe, it's time for me to retire from hair. Mm-hmm. And he agreed. And so I just moved full time here in California. So that afforded me to spend all the time that's needed to put into this brand. You can't really be part-time and try to get a brand on the
right,
market.
Right. But the critical thing too that you're saying is that you have a full-time partner with your husband who is your support, your kind of your backing. So when you were first getting started, I mean, he still had his position somewhere else before on full-time with you?
Let's make it clear. Okay. My husband has his own company.
So he has his own company.
Yes,
okay.
My husband has a green technology company.
Right. So yes. Then that helps, yes, with being able to, yes, have something to fall, yes, back on so that you could take off full time. Right?
Yes, yes. So he supports me wholeheartedly.
Wow.
With this process. And then my husband is the number one networker. And so, you know, in Chicago, he knows everyone because, mm-hmm, he's part of 100 Black Men. Actually, he's president in the Chicago area. And so the connections there, I mean, I tell you, it's not one person that has met us or tasted our brand that says, you know, let me just help you. Let me,
right,
see, let me see who
everybody
I know.
Everybody wants to empower,
yeah, so,
you.
So yes, let me see, because they want to see it successful.
Right.
And you know, he's my number one cheerleader. So he definitely wants to see it successful.
Yeah. So you have a whole team of cheerleaders. You have your husband, you have your two children. You definitely have me and the Bella Network.
Thank you.
But you have a whole community because you've already created a community through the work that you and your husband do, with your husband with the 100 Black Men and with you supporting him with that. So,
right,
you already had a sense of support just from your work in the community.
Correct.
So
correct.
I applaud that.
Yes.
Well, so we're getting down to the end of our show, and we just really want to thank Dee. We want to thank Women of Prominence, and watch us for next season. So, goodbye for now from Career Talk Bella Style. Hi, and welcome to Career Talk Bella Style. I'm your host, Alicia White Madison, along with Shay Calhoun, and we're so glad that you joined us. But we want to make sure that you like, share, and subscribe to 4Point Media LLC on YouTube. That's 4, F-O-U-R, P-O-I-N-T, Media, M-E-D-I-A, LLC on YouTube. Don't forget to subscribe. See you next time.
I still remember in the day that I was scared to touch you. How I spent my days dreaming, planning how to say I love you.